Welcome back, everyone, to French Bread's Dark Souls 3 Lore Run. I am French Bread, or Chris if you prefer. And we find ourselves, well, I'm not entirely sure, well, where we find ourselves. Wherever we were dropped off after completely sanely climbing into the back of that cage. As you can tell, after this quick toast, I've changed up my equipment a little bit, thrown on that awesome Mira gear, and I've crossed over to the other side of the pool so that we can perhaps have a chat with this guy right here. Let's take a look at him first. Depth of field. Alright, looks like a little bit of an elderly dude. He's wielding a flamberge. His armor set is definitely unique to Dark Souls 3, but his shield has basically, it's the Mira shield from Dark Souls 2. Looks like they changed the color up a bit, but otherwise the design remains the same. Which works for me because I'm a huge fan of round shields, and I really want the one he's got, but that is not an easy that is not an easy path. Let's just get to talking to him for now, though.
Well, what's up? This pit is for hollows, not for the likes of you sane folk. Or perhaps you are a hollow, posing as otherwise?
Sure. I mean, we did climb into that cage, right?
Yes. Then we are just fine. It's important to know who you are. But we'll all be mad soon enough. And should you be undead, well, all the more so. Beware. The shackles of the gods are fragile. You might need this. Etch it on your heart if you feel your sanity slipping.
Mound makers.
Come here to pile up your victims, for that will form your anchor. You'll see when you go mad. They'll be your family. You'll go mad one day. But not today. Take my advice. Use this bone and leave this place. This pit is for hollows and for the occasional madman fond of piling up victims. You've better things to do, I'd hope. This pit is for
you. Okay. So this dude is Holy Knight Hodrick, who you may remember tried to shank us a few episodes ago. True to his word, looks like he was invading other worlds, looking for the vertebra shackles so he could pile them up his mound, so to speak. A mound that would serve as an anchor for his sanity and his surrogate family. There's a lot more going on with Holy Knight Hodrick besides this mad hollow routine, which he may very well be mad, but we're going to be seeing more of him in the future. But for now, this is the extent of what we can do with him. Over here, got a War God wooden shield. Gee, that sounds cool, doesn't it? Wooden shield reinforced with metal, the largest of wooden medium shields. The bizarre pattern featured on the shield is the mark of a mad god, revered as a god of war in remote regions. I recognize this shield from Dark Souls 2. I believe this was used by the Lion Warriors. 84 physical. It's got pretty solid elemental defense, except for magic. It's got good stability. Really good stability. And it's light, so yeah, I can see people using this. And let's go through, now that we're here, with our typical item roundup section. Because I know we picked up a few things that I did not get around to talking about. The blue wooden shield being one of them. Wooden shield, painted bright blue, symbol of clerics who have become undead. Close to a small shield in size. Nothing of note there, though. Now we're in the equip screen. Let's back up. Let's see, any new consumables? Yes, there is. Pale Tongue. Proof of a Red Orb Invader's victory over a host of embers. Claiming tongues as trophies was originally the practice of an infamous troop of invaders who offered them to their speechless goddess. This is the first reference we're going to get towards a very important NPC in this game. One who, after some reflection, I decided that one of the biggest mysteries of the game revolves around. No new gems. We gotta remember to attune one of these this time. Alright. Oh yeah, we also got the Northern Armor. Iron armor of a stalwart Northern warrior, supported by interwoven chainmail. Iron defensive gear grants superior absorption, and being from the north, it should also offer resistance to cold. It's one of the starting weapon sets, so not a ton of lore per se, but solid set. Good weight, good defense, that sort of deal. Here we have the Flame Stoneplate Ring. Stone plates are symbols of true knights, and the red stone plates are granted to those who valiantly face chaos. So, this is a ring for those who are out to fight demons birthed from chaos, similar to the one that we took down earlier with Siegbro. And the Moundmaker's Covenant item. The malformed vertebra found by the Mad, with a queer symbol on its inside. Proof of the shackles of the gods. Equipped to pledge oneself to the Moundmaker's Covenant. The Moundmakers wish only to add to their mounds, becoming mad spirits, whether summoned as cooperators or invaders. They are blithe to kill those around them, for their minds, any kill might lead to another shackle. We also found the red bug pellet, now that I think about it. Medicinal pellet made from crushed insects. The red type temporarily boosts fire damage absorption. Prepared in the Cathedral of the Deep by evangelists who dole them out to followers to ease their suffering when they burn. That's interesting, I guess. It kind of implies that burning is an inevitability of life for followers in the Cathedral of the Deep. Alright, I think that concludes our item roundup. Let's take a quick look of our area. Look around our area here. As he said, we're in some kind of pit, I suppose. Lots of tree roots. We drop down around here, along with this immense collection of cages and wrapped bodies. So we know where a large portion of these bodies end up once they are prepared for burial. Suppose this is kind of the burial process. It is referred to as the Pit of Hollows. So after having their insides yanked out, toss the husks down here. It's a theory. As you can see, there is no way out of here except for the homeward bone. So we're going to use that to go back to the shrine. And we got a couple of reasons for coming to the shrine. One of them is because I'm an idiot. And...
Oh,
shush. did not buy the grave key while I had the chance. We definitely want that for where we're going. We also have the reappearance of a familiar, well, not face, but mask, I guess.
Well, hasn't it been some time? I'm Leonard, the Ringfinger. Remember me? I slipped you those red eyes some time ago. You're making quite an effort of it, so I thought you might like to know. If you yearn for a proper red-eye orb, one that is uncracked, then kill the Dark Wraith, survivor of the land swallowed by darkness. He has been a prisoner for many ages in the deepest cell in all Lothric.
Lift chamber key.
I can see it in your eyes. If you didn't invade, didn't pillage, whatever would you do?
Ringfinger Leonard here is under the impression that we have used a cracked red eye orb and killed someone because we have one of those pale tongue items, which is your reward for a successful invasion.
If you fancy a proper red eye orb, one uncracked, untainted, then kill the Dark Wraith, survivor of the land swallowed by darkness. He has been a- I can see it in your eyes.
Yeah. So, a surviving Dark Wraith from the land swallowed in darkness. I suppose that could mean one of two places off the top of my head. He might be referring to Ulysseal, which was being ate up by the Abyss when we encountered it in the Dark Souls 1 DLC, Artorias of the Abyss. Or he could be referring to New Londo, the city founded by the four kings that also succumbed to the Abyss due to the four kings themselves. Not sure, but somehow this Dark Wraith found his way to Lothric and was imprisoned. Those of you with good memories might have an idea of where his cell is. Let's toss on Flame Surge, see what that looks like, and then head out once more, this time to the dilapidated bridge. Alright, now that we're back in this area, we're going to do a bit of exploring, but this time, with that white pine branch in our possession, we should have an easier time of it. He caught me up a bit. Take thy pound of flesh. That's your right, I guess. This time, we got eyes in the sky. That's not terribly impressive, is it? Cornix, maybe there's a reason why this pyromancy was lost and forgotten. Not even a very good range on it. It does not seem to stagger them at all. I mean, granted, this... my pyromancy flame has not been upgraded at all. So that's gonna have an effect on it. But... as it stands, not a very impressive pyromancy. Unsurprisingly, around this white birch tree are tree limbs. Arrows of a giant rain down beside the white birch. This is a developer message, and I gotta say, that message is a little late if you're standing there, isn't it? Make a bold jump. Get our first undead bone shard. A vital, vital item indeed. Now that we're relatively safe, let's actually take a look at it as well. Undead bones that yet burn. Cast into the shrine bonfire to boost the recovery provided by the Estus Flask. The bonfire cinders are bones of undead, and a bone that still burns is a fresh cinder indeed. Before feeding upon death, one must first pray to it. That's a lot of flowery language, but you know, we never looked at the Kukri. Small throwing machete. Throw at enemies to cause bleeding damage, a unique weapon originally used by swordsmen of Karthus, but now popular among bandits and thieves. So there you go, that's another reference to Karthus. And this young white branch, that is not the one the giant gave us, has different information on it. Little Dust's first sorcerer staff eventually became a seedling. And then, three white birch saplings. The young branch is said to still contain echoes of Little Dusk's capriciousness. So, this is definitely a reference to Dusk of Ulaseel. She had a catalyst that was similar to this, and who else is going to be called Dusk, right? I never took her to be capricious, though. That's interesting. We'll have to read up on this as more items become available. And we already read the grave key, but let's also read this lift chamber key. Key to the room of the lift that descends to the deepest dungeon in Lothric. A surviving dark wraith from the land swallowed by darkness is said to be held there. Alright, well that's no new information there, but always good to check. Suppose. Oh, shoot. Thrall hood. Hood used to cover the head of lesser folk, who were set to work as slaves throughout Lothric. Also, occasionally used to shame and humiliate criminals. So here we go. I mean, finding a criminal's hood on Grey Rat, no shock there. But this also lets us know that slavery, completely normal and accepted practice, it seems, in Lothric. So, that's a damn shame. Ambush that just won't quit. We got this one. Alright. This guy actually drops a weapon, too. I've never been lucky enough to see it, though. Shit. I thought that might be like a good incantation to get him to drop it. Nope. Just superstitious nonsense. So it goes. For elegance sake, we're going to loop around this way to reach our next destination rather than using any warping. Homeward Bones. Forgot the name of Homeward Bone for a second. Cheeky. Very cheeky. Ooh, an item. It's the Evangelist hat. That dying gasp actually took me by surprise. Let's take a look at this Evangelist hat. Hat of the Evangelist sent from the cathedral. Well, nothing new here. Interesting look. Sticking with my crown though. For vanity's sake. it surprised me this time. Well, I question the usefulness of this move in a world without poise. Well, real poise. That reminds me, I was linked a post describing apparently the actual function of poise in this game. It seems like poise in Dark Souls 3 is equivalent to the stat adaptability, most especially the stat the attribute it impacted called agility, that improved the invincibility frames and distance of your roll. From what I've been seeing, apparently that's what poise actually does in Dark Souls 3. Whatever, I guess, but that's pretty misleading. A loincloth. And a statue of Velka. Man. Everybody wants to know about Velka. Everybody thought, hey, maybe this statue is an NPC? Maybe it'll talk to me? No. Of course not. They're never gonna let us have our Velka. Let's take a quick gander at the loincloth. I don't expect there to be anything fascinating there. Nope! Into the grave. Red-hilted halberd. We all know where this is going, right? Skeletons. These skeletons are actually kind of cool. They got that dirt tree thing going on. We got everybody. All the warriors are after us here. Human pine resin. I wondered if this guy would be here. Let's deal this ambush first. Ah, you took too long to attack, my friend. So this nonchalant hollow over here is not supposed to be here. For some reason, the enemy positions in this particular area are glitchy as hell, and they seem to frequently like fall through the world or spawn incorrectly, and they show up down here when they shouldn't. Kind of irritating, but so it goes. Let's hold the phone for this crystal lizard. Heavy gem. Do appreciate new gems to read up on. This motherfucker right here. Everybody's trying to catch us out, right? No item. Okay. Onward. I think we'll do another item roundup maybe mid-episode for confronting the boss, which we will be doing in this episode, finally. You can see up there, we got our devil bro. So that means we're close to that cage with the failed firekeeper. Yeah, I forgot to mention, the devil bro, which we'll be getting the name of shortly, did mention that... Man, fuck off, rats. Did mention that this woman was a lost cause. And that she just didn't turn out right. Well, we'll see how she reacts, but... There may be a bit more going on than is on the surface. Here's our cage. Shall open the door, which I gotta believe Devil Bro is perfectly capable of doing. Either she put herself here or he put her here. don't know, for her own protection or something else. Those are definitely the maiden's robes from Dark Souls 1 that Rhea wore.
Who is that? Someone there? Anyone? Oh, please, whoever you are, touch me. The dark surrounds me, nibbles at my flesh. Little creatures, they never stop biting. So please, hold out your hand and touch me.
So, we know Firekeepers are blind, or we're going to know that if you didn't already. And the nibbling darkness she refers to is most likely anyway, humanity from Dark Souls 1, which was kind of considered to be pieces of the Dark Soul, the original Lord Soul found by the Pygmy. Firekeepers at least seem to be like have become homes for swarming masses of humanity. This is certainly true for the Dark Moon Huntus, or Nightus, yeah, who was said to have been scarred into like ugliness basically by the swarming masses of humanity just underneath her skin. Let's go ahead and get touchy-feely.
There you are, so close indeed. And I am not entirely alone just yet. Praise the merciful gods above.
New emote.
Oh, forgive me. I am Irina of Karim. I came to this land so that I might be a firekeeper. Your touch has freed me from the darkness. You are a champion, then. I am weak and unfit to tend the flames. But if it would not trouble you, might I enter into your service instead?
Yeah, why not?
Oh, thank you, sweet champion. I shall take my vows. I, Irina of Karim, solemnly swear to serve you.
So that's interesting. She was kind of here, kind of succumbing to the darkness, and she states that she came to this land to become a firekeeper. What about why would you come to this land to become a firekeeper? Why not be a firekeeper anywhere, right? I wonder if it has something to do with, I guess, this being a hub, a nexus for the powerful Lords of Cinder, and more than likely, the first flame we're trying to keep lit.
You've gone and rescued her, have you? How very quaint. Pitying creatures that are beyond help. Yeah. Very well. I'm sick of looking after her at any rate. I am Egon, a knight of Karim. I am allied to you for as long as you assure the girl's safety. And only for that long. What's the matter? My terms are very simple. I am allied to you for as long as you assure the girl's safety. And only for that long.
Fair enough. Well, before we head back to the shrine, speak with Irina again, let's take a look at a few of the items we picked up. Got the heavy gem, famously used to forge Faerun greatswords. A warrior can appreciate a heavy weapon, for they scale effectively with strength. So, these are integrated into the Faerun greatswords, which are we're going to see are associated with the Undead Legion, the Abyss Watchers. It improves your strength scaling. Pretty straightforward. We also got this Saint's Talisman. Medium for casting miracles of the gods. Ivory talismans are given only to women clerics, and faith greatly affects their effectiveness. There is a certain frailty to this talisman, which undermines the steadfastness granted by its skill. I don't know if that's supposed to be some sort of unkind assessment of women. I don't think so. I think it's... well... I'm not sure. Maybe it is. I guess I'd have to think on it. This is more of a women's studies thing than it is a Dark Souls lore thing. And we got a plank earlier, but there is not a goddamn thing to say about that. It's a plank. Can't parry with it. Can't weapon skill with it. What are you doing with it? Alright, I believe that wraps up the items we have for the moment. So let's get ourselves back to the shrine real quick. We'll burn some of that ash and talk to Arena in her new home. Now we got a plus one Estus flask. It'd be a great help. Down here, Arena has chosen a humble location. I mean, she's blind. Maybe she didn't realize.
Oh, Champion of Ash. Welcome back. I was not meant to be a firekeeper, but I am honored to serve you beside the bonfire. The gods are ever merciful. My gratitude lies with them and with you. I am yours now. Your wish is my command.
Okay.
You know, in my home of Karim, I was a nun. I would be pleased to share the tales of miracles with you. Although, to be honest, I only know a few. But if I had a divine tome, I could tell you many tales and more. Oh, only I cannot see. Terribly sorry, but you'll have to find me a divine tome in Braille.
Alright, so Arena of Karim, a nun in her homeland, and Dark Souls 3 really sets up the idea that miracles are made manifest through these tales passed down by the gods. She sells us the Saint's Ring, bestowed upon a Karim saint. In Karim, saints give voice to the ancient tales. They memorize countless cumbersome sacred books and read them in sonorous tones, a function for which they are widely renowned. That's all she's got on her. And her miracles. Heal, elementary miracle cast by clerics. Nothing to say about that. Replenishment. Miracle once cherished by cleric knights. Replenishment is a relic of the old Lloyd faith, whose cleric knights were unfaltering in battle. So here's some more descriptions that illustrate that Allfather Lloyd is no longer a component of worship in the way of white. For whatever reason, his time has passed. Miracle taught by Morn, the Archbishop's Apostle. Caressing Tears is a tale of the many deaths surrounding the goddess Caitha, of whom Morn was a known follower. Caitha was a goddess from Dark Souls 2. God, what was she? Like the goddess of sorrow or the goddess of remorse, something along those lines. She was like a goddess known to Morn for the unjust deaths, deaths of people. Although I believe it was also implied that she may be a somewhat duplicitous god that also leads people to their death. I don't, again, Dark Souls 2, I don't fully remember. apologize. Now you have Homeward. A miracle taught to traveling clerics returns Caster to the lot, to the last bonfire used for resting, or to the bonfire in the shrine. It would normally link to one's homeland, only the curse of the undead has twisted its power, redirecting casters to a bonfire. Perhaps for undead, the bonfire serves as home. So these are the tales she has for us to start with, and as we can see, there's actually been a shift in clerics being associated with Kareem as opposed to Astora or Thorland as it was in Dark Souls 1, which is very interesting given that, you know, Kareem had this kind of bad reputation in those games.
Have a pleasant journey, Champion of Ash. I pray for your safety.
Well, I do appreciate that. Alrighty, ready. We've saved the girl. We've parlayed with the madman. I'm feeling like we've done everything we have to do in the Undead Settlement, except for the obvious. Taking on that boss. Let's do that. Ah, shit. I was gonna tune that other pyromancy Great Combustion, but whatever. We don't want to use a friggin' pyromancy against the boss. Pyromancies I'm actually most interested in are the ones that are buffing spells. Things that can improve our weapon, or like Power Thin that Hodrick used. That's what I want to be a part of. Okie dokie. This is quite an epic room. I know, it's an overused word, but it is. This room is amazing. Great place for a boss fight, right? We have a bunch of undead settlement dwellers worshipping, it seems, at the base of this tree. Kill old red eyes over here. Everything is going good. Just killing chumps. Ah, shit. So, this is a gross-ass boss, is it not? Curse Rotted Greatwood. Not only does it appear to be a tree-like creature, but it's covered in these disgusting pustules. When we're fighting it, there's really not a lot of damage we can do to the main body, and none to the wood body. Wonderful! That spin attack is probably the most dangerous thing it has in store for me. But as you can see, the main way of doing damage is destroying these pustules. You can hit that gross-ass hand as well. Rolling backwards. But breaking these things is going to do the most damage for us. As you can see, we're not letting it have an easy time here. Okay. this thing is pretty much down for the count, so let's give it a chance to show off some of its attacks. Hopefully not the grab attack of the hand. Holy shit! I ain't never seen that roll before. That's pretty cool. Ah. This is its big stand-up fall-over attack, as you can see. Avoid by simply walking to the left or the right. This is a fight that is just highly... its difficulty depends a lot upon your weapon, really. If you have a +3 weapon, you're going to have a pretty decent time of it. If you don't, it might be a lot more difficult, as it's going to take way more hits for you to break those pustules. Alright, as reward, we get the Soul of the Rotted Greatwood and a Transposing Kiln. How convenient. And if you look around, you might recognize that this is that Pit of Hollows that we had accessed before via the Cage Man. And shit! Odric didn't fare too well, and that Greatwood came crashing down. He'll be okay. He just needs a moment. I didn't show off last time I was here that this altar is where you can offer your vertebra shackles should you wish to level up the Covenant. We're not about that though. So let's light our bonfire and let's scoot back to Firelink Shrine to do some end of the episode housekeeping. Alrighty, let's check out our new items, because some of them are very important to us indeed. Let's look at the Soul of the Rotted Greatwood. Ever since its establishment, all manner of curses have managed to seep into the Undead Settlement. The worst of them were sealed away inside a spirit tree, but eventually the curses took their toll. So, okay. Here we go. All manner of curses seeped into the Undead Settlement, and they had this practice of attempting to transfer those curses to what I could only describe as a scapegoat in like the most classic sense, by imbuing the spirit tree with the curses they hope to rid themselves of them. I guess this is similar to like the Japanese practice of, you know, you draw a fortune, and if it's a bad fortune, you tie it onto a tree, I guess, to rid yourself of it. I've also heard of like other practices of using scapegoats, people or otherwise, to bear the burden of sin in place of a community. That seems to be what's going on here, and I suppose the Pit of Hollows was the Undead Settlement's way of kind of trying to get rid of the curse that was the curse or curses that were plaguing them. Let's see. And in our key items, we have the Transposing Kiln. An old Transposing Kiln from Corland, crafted with stitched crystal lizard hide, which is kind of cool. Give to Ludlith, Lord of Cinder, to conduct soul transposition. This kiln can transpose twisted souls to craft special items with their concentrated essence, deemed forbidden by those unable to make proper use of it. So this is how we get boss items and magics and weapons and all that good stuff. Forbidden art, though, in the wrong hands. I do think that is something to keep in mind, indeed. But we don't care. We're gonna give it to him because we want boss weapons. We want all that sick lore.
Fret not,
we know.
Listen, this might, before I was a...
Okay, nothing new there, so let's just go ahead and give him the kiln.
Oh, belike it is a transposing kiln in thy possession. Seeing better days, but methinks it shall suffice. Now, bring to me a twisted soul. Transposition is the art of extracting and coalescing the essence of a soul. In transposing a twisted soul, its true power transferreth to thee. Thy purpose is to seek lords and slay them. What's to fear in a little transposition now?
What to fear indeed. Egging us on a little bit, isn't he? Alright, so we got already a handful of items he can transpose for us. I don't know why this soul of a demon stuff is showing up. We didn't obtain a demon's soul. Maybe it's just because we beat that demon in with Sigurd? I don't know. But let's take a look at these. Hollow Slayer Greatsword. Immediately recognizable to Dark Souls 2 players as the Mira Greatsword, wielded by Lucatiel and her brother Aslatiel. Greatsword used for a lifetime by a masked knight, harbors the fears that lurk within the minds of Hollows, and is particularly effective against them. Bestowed to a proper Mira knight long ago, two-hand to execute special sword techniques. Interestingly enough, this description could, I feel, accurately describe both Lucatiel and her brother, Aslatiel, or I can't remember the exact pronunciation. Very cool, but very much more of a dex greatsword, so I don't think we'll get much use of it. Demon's Great Axe. This great axe, a favorite among demons, contains the strength of fire. The demons, born of chaos, harbor fire, and yet they are twisted and malformed, such that they were never meant to be. It seems like you can create a flare of flame with your weapon skill. Nothing we haven't already discussed there. Demons created by the chaos fire. Vort's Great Hammer. Great Hammer wielded by Vort, the Outrider Knight of the Boreal Valley. Weapon is imbued with frost and causes frostbite. Frost accumulates in the body, causing frostbite, which saps one's health, lowers absorption, and slows stamina recovery. So it's a nasty debuff. This is an interesting one. Arstor's Spear. One of the curses that festered within the belly of the Greatwood, and a terrible weapon favored by Earl Arstor, the Impaler. The spear is enwreathed in rotten, heavily poisonous meat. Defeating foes restores HP. As we can see, it's got a poison effect, and it's pretty nasty. Now, Earl Arstor is actually an individual who was referenced in Dark Souls 1 from, you guessed it, Kareem. And, I don't remember any spears being discussed, but he was certainly an individual with a healthy fear of the undead curse. I believe the curse bite ring made reference to this fact that he was seeking ways to defend himself from the undead curse. I guess it's somewhat fitting then that his weapon was considered in of itself a terrible curse and somehow found its way into the belly of the Greatwood. I feel like the Gathering Curses is another one of those tidbits that lends us towards believing that Lothric, at this point in time anyway, is a converging point for the world itself. Things are just kind of, the world is kind of collapsing in on itself as it ends. Demon's Fist. A demonic fist that burns with fiery essence. Its wielder can release this power through use of its skill. When two-handed, fists are equipped to each hand. There's an ability called Flame Whirlwind. Spin through opponents with abandon, flaming fists outstretched. Use a strong attack while spinning, or using a strong attack while spinning, utilizes your momentum to slam the ground with both fists. Ah, peerless reading. But, sounds like a Zangief move, doesn't it? Here's a huge one. The Pontiff's Left Eye. Bewitched ring that Pontiff Sullivan bestowed upon his knights. Recovers HP with successive attacks. Knights who peer into the black orb are lured into battles of death, transformed into frenzied beasts. No wonder the Pontiff only provides these rings to those dispatched to foreign lands. This is our first reference to Pontiff Sullivan, who, without a doubt, is one of the top three or four most important NPCs in Dark Souls 3. This guy we'll be talking about quite a bit as the game goes on, but I'm going to go ahead and call him a mastermind type character, because he kind of has his fingers in everything. Is there anything we want to transpose right away? Nah, not really.
Treat the file she is.
Shush with your repeating dialogue that we care not for. We are running over long, I know, but I want to do one more thing before we sign off, and that is talk to Grey Rat in his triumphant return.
Oh, hello. You've come at a good time. It took some prowling, but I finally made a score. Go on, have a gander.
He seems to be in fine spirits.
You can keep...
But he says the same thing there. Alrighty. So, God, I can't remember quite everything he had before. I believe this Divine Blessing is new, and we're not going to talk about that yet, because, or the Lightning Urn, because I have things to say about those. He returned with the Zweihander, of some interest to us. Ultra Greatsword with a large, long blade, wielded with two hands, yet still requiring great strength due to its weight. Execute powerful attacks that take advantage of its weight, or utilize its sharp blade and thrust attacks. Probably pretty good. Pontiff Knight Curve Sword, the Estoc, the War Pick. Is the Glaive new? Possibly the Glaive. And yeah, he sells the Knight Shield now. I believe the Pontiff Knight Shield is also new. And he sells the Knight Armor, which is the starting kit for the Knight class. And he also has the Assassin stuff now as well. I believe a few new arrow types. I'm not going to go into those just yet. We're going to do that in the next episode due to us running over long. I am going to pick up this War Pick, though, which is a Warhammer with a hard, prolonged head. It was originally a pickaxe, but was refitted for battle. This simple but deadly weapon hits heavily with thrust damage, easily puncturing metal armor. It has a skill called Galvanize. Temporarily boosts stamina recovery speed by sheer force of will, or perhaps as a channeling of the original owner's industrious efforts. I'm going to buy one of these, because this is the next weapon we're going to use for a while, I do believe.
Goodbye, and stay safe. Oh, this place is a bore.
Already itching to get out there again. Alright, guys. We have pushed as much content as we can in this episode. So I'm going to sign off here and bid you all adieu. Hope you'll join me for the next one. See ya.